I'm Russ Sharples, and I'm the honored to be the chairman of the Stanley County Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors this year. So it has fallen upon me to welcome you and to give thanks for the meal we'll partake of here shortly. So if you would, please bow your heads, please. Lord, as always, we are so very grateful for the many, many opportunities you continue to afford us here to gather together, to share in fellowship and friendship. We also are very mindful of the many opportunities that you continue to bless Stanley County with, that particularly the leaders in this room have a tremendous responsibility to do everything that they can to move our county forward. We ask that you bless the food we are about to partake of, to the nourishment of our bodies. In your name, amen. All right, and I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Mike Harwood. Please congratulate Mike. He's the driving force behind this every year.
Thank you. Thank you. Trust me, I'm glad to be here. For those of you who don't know, you had a lot with me to make sure the event happens, along with the chamber staff. And I'd like to recognize my committee members. And if you would, just stand when I call your name. We have Reed Furr from Stanley Community College. I don't believe Ben Jolly is here tonight, but Ben Jolly with Carolina's Healthcare System. Mark Mabry from Mabry Insurance. We have Brett Spay from First Citizens. I haven't seen Brett just yet either. Toby Thorpe from City of Albemarle. Oh, is Brett here? Oh, Jack, yeah, Jack Ingram also. If those guys are standing, give them a round of applause. The Chamber Hall of Fame display case, if you haven't been there, is across the street at the Stanley Commons, the old Quimby Mall. And the display case is really, really full of memorabilia. And actually, we have outgrown what we have. And we will be adding to that display case in the near future, so we'll have more room for more memorabilia from our recent inductees. So if you ever get the chance to go, check out the Hall of Fame display. There are some really, really neat things in there. One of the old mics from Bob's radio station days is in there. We have some Ryder Cup things from Johnny Palmer. Just a lot of neat stuff. So go check that out, and hopefully we'll have some neat stuff from Jeff and Brad soon also. But it is across the street. A lot of folks ask me and ask the chamber, how do you nominate someone to be a member of the Hall of Fame? There is a nomination form at the Chamber of Commerce office. You can call them at 982-8116, or you can go by there. And the committee assembles these nominations each year, and we have an anonymous committee that makes the selection each year. And believe it or not, we still have folks who are in college Hall of Fames who are not in the Stanley County Hall of Fame as of yet. And so there's a lot of deserving folks that we're trying to get into the Hall of Fame and that eventually will be members. I know these two guys in here tonight have been nominated for quite a while, and we've finally gotten around to them, and they are certainly deserved. So that's how you nominate someone for the Hall of Fame. And it's not just sports. Sports has a big part of it, but it's other things that they do in their lives as far as community and everything else that the committee looks at. So that's how you handle that part of it. I certainly would like to congratulate Jeff and Brad. They are well-deserved. And I meant to tell Jeff, this Hall of Fame display, you know, we're looking for things to put in there. You don't remember this probably, but way back when I played junior Babe Ruth baseball, we played a game at the Carolina Avenue Park, and it was the staff against us kids. And you came up to bat, and I was pitching. And I knew right off the bat I was in trouble because I didn't have catcher's equipment on, because if you hit one back at me, I was going to die. But somewhere in the Wiscasset Mill site over there across that ditch is a ball you hit. And we're going to go find that thing and put it in the display case because it left town. And I know you did it because I watched it go. So anyway, and Brad, I think, goes down as Coach Dave Holcomb's least fussed-at player he ever had, because Brad never made any mistakes. Of course, then again, he was so tired of fussing at Craig Cordes, he probably didn't have much else to do. And speaking of Craig, will you stand? This is Craig's first return to Stanley County for this event. Craig was an All-American at Pfeiffer University and played for Coach Holcomb at Albemarle. And we appreciate Craig driving down from Raleigh and surprising Brad. So anyway, each year We absolutely could not do this without the hard work and dedication of this gentleman, as well as Woody in the past has always been here. I think he may have missed one before tonight. Woody couldn't be here due to a conflict that came up. And Bob Harris has really gone out of his way to help make this thing take place. He contacted Gary Hahn for us and asked Gary to come down. And even though, you know, they're rivals up there, maybe not so much as with Woody, but anyway, Bob really, really, really does a good job helping us out. And I just can't thank Bob Harris enough. Let's give him a round of applause. And I do want to tell everyone, I know Mr. Knotts, Bear Knotts, is an inductee, and I don't believe he's here with us tonight. And I did talk with Coach Webb, Toby Webb, this week, and he wanted to send his regrets for not being able to make it. He's in a facility in New Bern, and it was just too far for him to come, and I think this is the first one he's ever missed. But without further ado, I want to turn the program over to the 39-year voice of the Duke Blue Devils, Mr. Bob Harris.
Well, it's certainly good to be back in the red clay hills of Stanley County again. And we were talking about the number of halls of fame that we have had, the banquets. And I think the only one that I have missed was about the fourth or fifth year when we had a schedule conflict. Duke was playing basketball in Boston on a Tuesday night. I had to leave on Monday afternoon, so I didn't get a chance to come down, but I've been here for every other one. And it is always a pleasure to come back and see a lot of the same familiar faces who, you know, have been here almost every year. And we appreciate you for that. My first duty for tonight is to welcome back those members of the hall who tonight were able to get here and were able to be a part of our program this evening. And as I call your name, would you please stand and let everybody recognize you. First of all, if we're going to do this by class, from the class of 1990, Don Montgomery, represented by Ann Bird. Ann? From the class of 1992, Coach Joe Fairby. Coach? From the class of 1993, some guy named Harris. For the class of 1995, Charles Meisenheimer, represented by Ben. Ben, where are you? Thank you. From the class of 1997, Bill Furr, represented by Barbara Morton. Barbara? From the class of 1998, Dave Holcomb. From the class of 2000, Doug Knotts, represented by his son, John. From the class of 2002, Joe Austin, represented by Mary Atkins. From the class of 2007, Lonnie Chandler. From the class of 2008, Curtis Watkins and Johnny Watkins, represented by son Johnny. Please stand. From the class of 2011, Bubba Lisk. From the class of 2012, Don Davis. And from last year's class, Jack Ingram. And also the late Kermit Young, who is represented tonight by Adelaide McNeil and Les Young. How about one more round of applause for the entire group? Thank you. As Mike said, we are missing one who has not missed this banquet before, Coach Toby Webb, but he's here in spirit. We know that. And for as many people as he has guided and affected in their lives throughout his career. We just want to say thank you. And I know they're going to make a tape of this to go back, and Coach is going to get one. So could we give Coach Toby Webb a big hand? Now, did I miss any of the inductees or any of those representing an inductee? Good. All right. Now we move on to the portion of the program that so many of you are here for. And our first inductee, Brad Childress, is a former head coach of the Minnesota Vikings and attended high school at Marmion Academy in Aurora. Wait a minute, that's not the right one. The Brad Childress that we are inducting tonight is a young man that I've known most all of his life, mainly through my long-term association with his dad. And life in the Childress household in the 70s centered around basketball. I got to know the family when Tom became the basketball coach at Pfeiffer University. And he and I did a Saturday morning talk show about basketball that's still drawing rave reviews, even though we haven't done it in a couple of years, Tom. But I guess it was only natural that Brad should play the game. He became a standout at the at Albemarle High School in the mid-1980s and started at point guard for the Bulldogs for 3 years and earned all Rocky River Conference honors for all 3 years. Not only that, he didn't miss a single game during his high school career. Brad established himself as one of the best high school players in the state of North Carolina during his senior year of 1986. He led Albemarle to the second straight conference championship and earned Conference Player of the Year. He was the ringleader of a Bulldog team that set the best season mark in school history, 30-1. That one loss was to the eventual state champion. Childress was named to the All-Piedmont team, selected for the East-West All-Star Game. He earned a basketball scholarship to Campbell University, and he was an outstanding student as well and earned membership in the National Honor Society. When the Stanley News and Press picked their all-time Albemarle High School team in 1997, Childress was selected as the point guard. I was left off that elite group because they didn't pick an all-time PA announcer, which I did very astutely my senior year. Now, down at the creek, as they say about Campbell, in that part of the state anyway, Brad, Childress only increased his reputation as an outstanding player and student. He started at point guard in his very first game as a Camel, and he didn't miss a game for the next 4 years. He made all-conference 2 years, scored over 1,000 points, had 500 assists, 200 rebounds, and still holds the Campbell school record for steals and total minutes played. Over 4,000 minutes, and he ranks third on the career assist list. He earned his BA in Business Administration from Campbell in 1990 and a Master's in Counseling Education from Lenoir Ryan in 92, and guess where those degrees led him? Coaching. He decided to follow Pop's career and coach basketball at the college level. He did for 6 years, and three of those were at Campbell, where he amassed a winning record, including 20-9 in his last year. Now, it was time for a career change, and Childress entered the healthcare industry as a consultant for Pfizer Incorporated and is now a high-ranking executive with that giant. In February of 2013, Brad Childress was elected into the Campbell University Sports Hall of Fame. Tonight, we catch up with them. And it's time now for me to present, and it's my honor to do so, for induction into the Stanley County Sports Hall of Fame, Brad Childress.
Okay, that was even better, especially that last part. My Pfizer colleagues here will appreciate that last executive writing in there. I'm not sure I'm there yet, but I'm working my way up. But I'm humbled for this honor. I didn't even know, honestly, I was on the ballot. And really anxious and looking down the list of people that have, you know, that are part of this organization. So I was, you know, I really didn't know if I truly belonged. And then I keep looking down and I see Jack Ingram. And I'm thinking, you know, maybe I should, I do belong. I mean, Jack's 40 years old, he could dunk it, you know, but, or at least he tried to dunk it at 40. But so I felt a little bit better about it at that point. But what a list of people to join, and the booklet speaks for itself. So I'd just like to thank a number of people. First, my wife Anna, who is, she's not really, doesn't have a great basketball mind, but she does have a fashion mind. Nobody else here told me that I was wearing plaid and stripes. It doesn't go together. But I didn't. Nobody else but Anna, right when I got in the car. Didn't even pay attention until I got in the car. But quick story about Anna. I did tell this at the Campbell Hall of Fame, which is kind of gives you a life. But she's indulged a lot of Albemarle stories, a lot of, you know, sports stories coming from Stanley County. So we were up in New York, and a friend of mine asked me to play ball. So I'm running out the door. And this is a true story. Anna will vouch for me. I'm running out the door, and she says, "You're not going to wear that, are you?" I said, "Well, we really don't care what we wear when we just play. It's just play. Throw on your high tops, you go." So get there, and sure enough, playing at the YMCA in Stamford, Connecticut. And what happens to me at 5'9" is they're backing me down. They're posting me up, and all I hear from the bench is, "Mismatch, mismatch, mismatch. Giving them all, mismatch." You know where this is going. So I go home and tell Anna. I say, "Hey, you know what? The whole bench was yelling mismatch. They thought me having." She said, "I told you not to wear that." That is a true story. And then she tells my dad, who's got a long coaching career, and dad's just kind of looking around, looking at it. Also want to thank my kids are here too. I have twin boys that are 5, and I have a 9-year-old little girl, Tatum. And I was going to tell a story on Tatum, but she said, "Do not do that, Daddy." So I will not. Want to thank my dad, Mom, Dad, for your thousands and thousands of rebounds and tips, you know, throughout the years in high school and college. So that was I don't know if I'll be able to do that if my sons want to, you know, push that hard and continue to work out and that type stuff. But, you know, Dad would always mix it up by wanting to challenge it to free throw shooting contests. That was his strength, free throw shooting. So he would get down and, you know, he'd have the little push shot, and very often he would win. We couldn't really match his free throw ability. But not only that, you know, and even playing for Coach Holcomb, Dad would talk about, you know, what are you trying to do when you're on the court? And I know he talked to Paul about this as well. You know, are you going to make a pass and just cut away? Or are you going to try to initiate, make the team better, make some things happen? So, you know, that little insight always stuck with me, because he said, you can pass to the wing and go screen away. Beth could do that, is one of the examples he gave. Beth could do that. It might be slow, but she would get there for that screen. And then after that, he didn't miss a beat. Then he said, you can pass and, you know, screen away. Trent Hatley could do that. You know, Trent could do that, but, you know, that'd be a heavy screen. Trent would knock somebody out. Y'all know Trent. But again, Dad provided that insight. And also, we all knew when we'd go to the gymnasium, Pfeiffer would be practicing. Craig can attest to this. He helped me with my quickness in a way that if you're shooting on the sidelines and he blows the whistle to make a point and argue, get on one of his teammates, do not let that ball hit the ground again on the sideline. So you got to shoot it and you got to follow it, because he's going to give you that dirty look. If your ball hits the ground, he's trying to make a point to his team. So we really worked on our quickness getting to those rebounds. He had a mean look, didn't he, Craig? Yes, he did. That one eyebrow went down, and it was over. And Mom was also very helpful, very competitive, played high school basketball. She's the 5'1 Magic Johnson. If you haven't seen my fam, Paul and Jeff, she would back you up. Just back you up, back you up, back you up at 5'1". And then if you touched her, it was a foul. That was it, you know? And then she would argue about it. But that was she got pretty physical on the sidelines of the Pfeiffer practices as well. Moving on to my brothers. I think everybody knows Jeff, Paul, and then my sister Beth. But Jeff was surprisingly one of my biggest fans. I remember, you know, he went to North Stanley, and it's a wonder he didn't get kicked out of the gym as much as hard as he pulled for the Bulldogs, wherever we went. So, Jeff, thank you for that. Continue. Paul, as you know, was a very good player himself. We shot thousands and thousands of shots too. And I, you know, it'd be interesting to see how many shots that we put up. Paul made five or six of those. I mean, we really worked. And he got a scholarship to East Carolina, started as a freshman, and had a really good career overall. Then he ended up at Pfeiffer. And quickly, one of my most embarrassing stories happened when Paul was guarding me. He was a freshman at ECU. I'm a senior. Close game, second half. Heath, you and Steve will relate to this. I get the ball inbounds. It's a pretty tight game, and I double-tie my shoelaces. In the second half, they had come apart, so it's two big flopping shoelaces. And as I take the ball, it was Lenny Wirtz, who was the short official from the ACC. I get the ball and turn, and one shoe gets in the loop of the other shoe, and I just face plant right on the backcourt of ECU, Minji's Coliseum. Okay? Fortunately, Paul's at the other end guarding the top of the key, 1-2-2 zone. He was not full court press. Otherwise, it would have been a layup. But if you ever played at East Carolina at Minji's, it's a loud place to play. I think, you know, they may be required to drink one or two beers. Not to paint a wide brush at East Carolina. Wait a minute, Doug, you were there, weren't you? Okay, I'm going to paint a wide brush, East Carolina. But it was a good opportunity, and Paul and I played together and improved. We made each other better. And Beth, she also rebounded quite a bit for me. We'd force her. We'd give her a dollar allowance, and we'd be in the old gym, and she would rebound and rebound. I was hoping Snake Roberts might be here tonight. Les was always, you know, he said he was so busy at Pfeiffer College. He was a security guard there, if you didn't know. But he would just kind of hang back. If anybody's been to Mitchell Gym, it's kind of a creepy gym at times at night. I mean, it creaks, and especially when you turn the lights out and run back through. Well, Beth and I happened to be in there one day, and after Snake, he's hanging out for 45 minutes, even though he's always on top of stuff, busy, busy. He knocks this white metal trash can down the metal steps, and I was gone. You talk about quickness, and Beth was left behind. But Snake, all you could hear him was laughing. So I was hoping he would be here so I could tell that story. Also, my teammates at Albemarle, I mean, what a setting that Coach Holcomb and Al, that foundation of success, that foundation of leadership, the high expectations, the discipline. So Coach, which I really needed at that time, and Dad had the foresight to say, you know what, this might be a good fit for you over here, not because of the discipline specifically, Coach. You knew how to coach, and I took great benefits from all those lessons. So I can't thank Coach enough for taking me on as a sophomore, and he treated everybody the same. You know, maybe everybody fairly, not equally, knew your strengths and weaknesses, but as far as motivating and as far as just having a great time, putting in perspective winning and losing, and I think Coach Andrew helped him put wins and losses in perspective because, you know, Coach wants to win the game, right? We all wanted to win the game. So and Coach Andrew, I think, was an interpreter as well, you know. If everybody knows Coach Holcomb has been yelled at, you don't always know exactly what he's saying. So you look at Coach Andrew, he says, oh, go down and run the wheel. Okay, Coach. And then you go, and then you complete that task. So, but thank you so much. And two very successful coaches, and I would argue two of the most successful coaches back-to-back in the state of North Carolina. Teammates, Albemarle teammates, I don't see any that made it here tonight, but I had some calls. And, again, we were one unit, one team, supported each other. Didn't matter if you were on the bench or you played all the time. So that's a unique atmosphere created by the coaches. Cordes is here, one of the all-time greats at Albemarle High School and beyond. So, Craig, thank you again for driving all the way from Raleigh. My friends that are here, you know, Albemarle friends and also Richfield friends. You know, you got David and Trent, David Earnhardt, Trent Hatley. David and I used to ride our bikes on Highway 52 on each side. You can't do that nowadays, going from Richfield to Pfeiffer, throwing behind the back passes and leading each other. You know, just working on our passing. I don't know, you know, we never got hit. Nothing ever bad happened. Trent taught me how to play very physical. You know, there was no uncontested layup with Trent Hatley on the floor, let me tell you. But thank you guys for coming. I really appreciate it. Campbell friends in the house tonight. My college roommate, Heath Van Dievender. Heath was a 6'7". We were both came in at the same time, freshman. I made the mistake of telling Heath he was 6'6" one day. No, he's 6'7". 6'7". Very good player in his own right. In fact, I would not have been able to come back to Stanley County He had one of his best games against Pfeiffer our senior year at Campbell. Coach Lutz had a great team. Tony Smith was point guard. You know the rest of the story. So we were fortunate to get out of there on that, thanks to Heath's efforts. Steve Bruce, also my sweet mate from Indiana, 6'3 guard. We made each other better each and every day there in college. Steve, thanks for coming. And then finally, my Pfizer friends that are here, Scott Sagerster, my former manager at Pfizer, great coach, great leader, great vision. His son, by the way, is the director of media relations for the Washington Capitals at the young age of what, ripe old age, 26, 27. So he kind of set that standard. Scott did at his home, and Pace is doing extremely well. And Bridget Jones, my colleague in the Durham area, thank you, Bridget, for coming. We just got back on a long trip last week. She managed to get here. So, big Carolina fan. Came despite Woody not being here. But, guys, again, it's an honor. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And I really, you know, I just thank the Lord that our paths crossed. I was fortunate enough to come across you. Thank you.
When this Hall of Fame started back in 1989, we were inducting sports luminaries that I grew up hearing about and watching. And as time moved along, we were inducting my peers. And now we're inducting stars that I had the pleasure of even broadcasting some games for. And even those whose athletic prowess began after I left Stanley County. Tonight's second inductee is one of those that I got to watch for a couple of years and talk about while broadcasting high school football, basketball, and baseball here. Jeff Wasner was a star baseball player at South Stanley High School during those 70s. From 73 to 77, he was a four-year starter for the South Stanley Rebels, and he made all-conference all 4 years. The team's captain during his final 3 years at South, as well as the team's MVP, and he won the team's Sportsmanship Award his last 3 years. He earned all-county honors in 1975. That was the last year I picked those teams prior to going to Durham. While in high school, Wasner was also very active in the Babe Ruth baseball program in summer months. And during part of his playing career, he won the league batting championship from 1976 to 78 and was named the Athlete of the Year in 76 and 77. He had a 17-2 pitching record with 3 no-hitters and struck out 20 batters in a game against the Mooresville American Legion team. Now, after graduation from South Stanley, Jeff matriculated to Wingate University on a baseball scholarship and continued his excellent play there as a member of the Bulldogs teams from 78 to 82. His specialties were playing third base and pitching. He is still widely regarded as the best third baseman in Wingate history. And I was down there a week ago today, and they still talk about his play as a third baseman. During his years over in Union County, Wasner was all-conference, all-district, team captain, and he led his team to the conference championship 3 times from 80 to 82. In 81, the Bulldogs made it to the Southeastern Regional Finals before losing the championship game. Then in 1982, he signed to play with the Atlanta Braves organization. And even after retiring, Jeff has continued to be very active in baseball in many positions. He was the first coach of the Stanley County American Legion team when it was reestablished in 1984 and did that for 3 years. He served as a scout for the New York Yankees, Chicago White Sox, the Washington Nationals, and he served as both a coach and the district commissioner for the Babe Ruth baseball organization from 1984 to 1990. He continued to conduct baseball clinics across the state of North Carolina. He also graduated from the UNC School of Government and taught a recreational segment in those 4 years. Jeff now lives in Wadesboro and serves as the Director of Parks and Recreation for Anson County and is the Director of Facilities for the county. He served as the chairman of the Anson County State Employees Credit Union, chairman of the Anson County Special Olympics, and as a Sunday school teacher in his church. In 2006, he was inducted into the Wingate University Hall of Fame, and now it's my honor to present for induction tonight into the Stanley County Sports Hall of Fame, Mr. Jeff Wasner. Jeff?
You know, I've been working on this speech for a long time, and I'm known to be long-winded. And then I was told that I had to shorten it down, so then I worried myself to death for 5 days trying to decide what I was going to take out of my speech. So I'm going to try to do the best I can and try not to bore you while I'm up here. First of all, I'd like to give thanks to Almighty God for all the blessings that He has bestowed upon me in my life. I want to thank Him for all the people, wonderful people, that He has put in my life. And I want to thank Him for this honor that I have tonight. Being in a room like this with a lot of people, it brings back a memory, and some of the guys here have heard this before, of a story I heard Yogi Berra tell in spring training. He said when he retired from the Yankees, they gave him a retirement dinner. Well, that night he gets up to give his speech, and the owner of the Yankees said, "Yogi, before you start, we've got a gift we'd like to give you." So they presented him with a grandfather clock. Well, he was all excited, but he didn't come that night prepared to take a grandfather clock home. So he gave his speech, and when he finished, the room emptied, and he thought, "Well, here's the grandfather clock. Might as well take it out in the hallway so I can be easier to get to." So he grabs it like we've all done and kind of shimmied it out. Well, as he's going through the doorway, he runs into a gentleman, knocks him to the floor. He didn't know who the man was, and Yogi kind of said, "Why don't you watch where you're going?" Well, he said the guy stood up, wiped his pants off, and looked at him and said, "Why don't you wear a wristwatch like everybody else?" And he swore that to be the truth. You know, there's so many individuals that we need to think when we're up here, and Brad's the same way. And when you start naming names, you leave people out. But there's a few special people I need to recognize tonight. I want to thank the Chamber of Commerce for this award. I want to say a special thank you to Stephanie Gresham, to Mike Harwood, and to Bob Harris. I also want to thank the Hall of Fame Committee for this distinguished award. And I want to thank Toby Thorpe. Toby called me and known Toby most of my life. And the day that he called me, I was in a meeting, and he said, "I can't hear you." And I said, "Call me on my cell phone." And when he called me back, I said, "What can I do for you?" And he told me this, and I just quit talking. So the next day, I called Toby back as soon as I got to work and asked him, "Did you call me yesterday?" He said, "I sure did." So I was kind of like Brad. I thought, where did it come from, and do I deserve to be in there with those folks? But he, too, I met Jack coming up the steps, and I thought, well, there it goes. And I want to thank the, sorry about picking on you so much, Jack. I want to thank the current Hall of Fame members and say it's an honor to be in this select group of people with you folks. I want to congratulate you, Brad. It's an honor to go in with you tonight. I want to thank my Wingate family and friends for being here. Bill Nash, Tim Roney, Joel Barham, Steve Van Hoy. You know, I try to talk about this and not get emotional, but you're talking about knowing people for 35 years, and, you know, we went through a lot of stuff, you know, playing baseball and living together, and we're all losing our hair, turning gray, except for Coach Nash, and he looks just like he did when we were playing for him 35 years ago. So I want to thank you guys so much for being here. I want to thank Marion Ratliff and Wendell Small for them coming tonight, and those are my recreation boys from Anson County, and so it means a lot for those guys to be here. I'm delighted that my brother and his two daughters are here tonight, Sierra and Grayson, and thank you for coming. I love you very much. I do want to say a special thank you to Ruth and Larry McMahon. And if I may, Ruth, I want to say you and Tommy were like, this will make me kind of cry, but you were like second parents to us. And I'm just sorry Tommy can't be here tonight. to share these memories. I want to say to my mom and dad, thanks for the wonderful and secure childhood that you gave me and all the sacrifices that you both made to allow me to go to college and get my college degree, play college baseball. And I love you both very much. She told me not to do this, but Chris, you're a ray of sunshine, and you are one of the best people I've ever met, and you make every day exciting and a pleasant experience, and I love you dearly. Well, I didn't play organized baseball until I was 11 years old. We lived in Albemarle, but I went to school at Aquadale, and our next-door neighbor, his name was Jeffrey. He went to Norwood because his mother was a teacher there. Well, he was always coming home bragging to us about playing Little League, the team, how they were doing, how much fun he was having. And he said, hey, Saturday they're having tryouts, so why don't you go down and see if you can make a team? So my mother took me down that morning, and that was my first baseball experience. Must have been 40 kids there that day. We ran, we shagged flies, we took ground balls, we hit, and we pitched. My mother said she remembers seeing me pitch that day, and all the kids were swinging and missing, and she didn't know anything about baseball. Said she was embarrassed when one of the dads walked up to her and said, who is that boy pitching? She didn't want to tell him I was her son because she thought I was doing something wrong. Well, the coaches told us that the teams would be posted in Norwood on Monday. Well, I couldn't wait to get home from school to see what team I made. Jeffrey gets home that day, and he comes flying across the yard. You didn't make a team. You didn't make a team. So I run in the house crying. Nerves were shot. Mom and Dad was out planting some flowers, and they said, come on out with us and help us. So I go out, and it wasn't just a few minutes, till this red pickup truck pulled up in the driveway, and it was Mr. Tommy Underwood. We didn't know Tommy, but he got out and introduced himself and said that he didn't post his team at Norwood on Monday because he didn't have time. He said that he had the first pick on Saturday, and he had taken me. And that filled my heart with joy. And at 55 years old, when I think of that day and think of Tommy, it still fills my heart. And I wanted Ruth to know that. You know, I try to make my speeches a little bit uplifting, but I had some things I needed to say that I hadn't been able to say to people for many years. But when I was 17 years old, our Babe Ruth League All-Star team, we advanced to the state tournament in New Bern. And we were coached by Joe Kelly, Hall of Fame member. Well, we get down to New Bern and go to the gym with all the other teams and players, and all the players were staying with host families. Well, after about an hour or so, there was four players left. Al Andrew, Richard Furr, Sam Alley, and me. Well, we just stood and looked at each other. Well, then in about 10 minutes in walked these two guys. Woody and Mike were their names. Well, Woody smiled at us, and he said, I'll take those two. So he took Al and Sam. Well, that left me and Richard Furr with Mike. Now, Mike was this big old intimidating guy. He looked just like Joe Don Baker from the movie Walking Tall. So he took us, and he introduced himself, and lo and behold, he was the sheriff of Craven County. So as we were walking to the car, people would say, hey, Buford, how you doing? What's going on, Buford? And when we get to his car, this true story, it was an unmarked car, and in the front seat was a huge stick about this big. Richard and I were scared to death. So we get in the back seat like a couple of jailbirds, and Mike turns around and says, I got a couple of things to tell you fellas before we leave. He said, there's plenty of food and drink in the house. You can have all you want. He said, the television's yours, but my wife is pregnant, so don't even think about it. Well, Richard and I didn't know what he was talking about. It scared us to death. So when we get to his house, which is way out in the country, guess who he lived beside of? Woody. So Al, Sam, Richard, and I were back together again. We rode the boats, we went to the country club, and we went on the drug bus one night. That's the truth. And when we got back, I mean, Mike would pull up and bump cars with his sheriff's car. I mean, he was radical, wasn't he, Al? So we get back to the ball field, and our other teammates would talk about how boring and long their day was, and then we'd start telling about all these stories we had. But Richard and I always wondered what the fans must have thought of us when we'd pull up in a deputy's car and get out of the back seat in our uniform every game. So after high school, I chose Wingate to play baseball and get my education. And I can't write or say what Wingate University has meant to me, both as a person and a baseball player. And I couldn't have had any better coaches, no matter where I went, than Steve Poston, Bill Nash, and legendary coach Ron Christopher. You know, our college team, we did everything together. We played football, we played basketball, we even made a few movies. And we recycled a few girlfriends. And we were playing at home one day against Gardner Webb, and this is a Coach Christopher story. Had a pitcher that had been out most of the season. Well, we scored 26 runs that day. So the coach got him in to let him get some work. Their cleanup hitter was about 6'4 left-hander. And he came up with the bases loaded and took Ricky's best fastball, hit it so far in the right center field that when it hit the side of a van, it was a delay in the sound getting back to me at third base. Well, coach comes out and checks him and says, "Ricky, are you okay?" And he said, "I'm fine, coach." And he said, "Well, bear down, we got a big lead." Well, as coach proceeded to leave, he turned around, and I quote, he said, "Son, he hit that ball further than I can damn point." And then another day, we were playing. Our first baseman said, "Hey, everybody," and we went into the mound. So I go in expecting some baseball strategy. And he said, "Look, don't all you guys turn around at one time. But that girl that's wearing that red dress is killing me." And so I go back, and I'm thinking, man, what are we doing? So after my college career, I had a brief professional career in the Atlanta Braves organization. I had the opportunity to meet some of my childhood heroes, Hank Aaron, Ted Williams, Yogi Berra, and Bob Gibson. I got to play against Darryl Strawberry, Andy Van Slyke, and Fred McGriff. You know, my experiences in that was far too many, just to name a few. So it was what I had dreamed. It just didn't last enough. In 1984, there was a group of men who was very enthusiastic about starting American Legion Baseball, and some of them, I think, are in this room. And I can remember just how overwhelming the support was from businesses and individuals throughout this county. And they selected me to be their first head coach. And I was so honored to coach alongside Al Andrew. Now, Al and I were young boys back then. And we had a lot of crazy things that happened that first year. There's stories that I can't tell. But I remember, and I still remember this day, I'd hear Al say, "Coach!" And I'd turn around and look, and he'd say, "I got to write a damn book." And I wish you'd have written that book, Al, because that would be a great read. Not only was I American Legion baseball coach, but I worked at the city parks and rec. I had T-ball and Little League in the mornings, Tenor League in the afternoons, and to top it all off, I was the head coach of the 14, 15-year-old Babe Ruth team that Jamie Kimry played on, Shim Dog. Well, we were struggling in American Legion, but we ran the table that year in Babe Ruth. We were 17-0 on an 18-game schedule. We'd go to the last game of the season, playing at Norwood, bases loaded, first and third, two outs. Kevin Gardner, who was one of our better pitchers, was pitching. So I go out, told him to throw from his stretch, watch the guy back at third, don't worry about the runner at first. So I go back to the dugout, Kevin goes to his stretch, looks the runner back, throws to the empty first base, ball goes in right field, we finish the season 17-1. So I hollered at him, "What the heck, Kevin?" He drops his head and walks off the mound. Said, "Coach, I was trying to catch him asleep." So I'm still wondering who he was trying to catch asleep. Well, I was so proud to be chosen as the first American Legion head coach and be part of the resurrection of American Legion baseball in Stanley County. You know, Albemarle and Stanley County, they should be proud because that group of men built something that has lasted for 30 years. And tonight, with a dry mouth, I've told you a few of my baseball stories. Now, my baseball playing career went from playing and coaching to scouting. I worked for the White Sox for 20 seasons. I was privileged to watch games from Asheville to Charleston. And I had the opportunity to see Josh Hamilton and Madison Bumgarner pitch in high school. You know, baseball has been a blessing to me in my life, to say the least, but it has brought me some heartaches. But it's brought me many hours of joy, and it's brought me friendships that are priceless. So tonight, as I finish, I've just got to say Albemarle was a wonderful place to grow up. We had so many wonderful traditions. We had the Good O, we had Joe's Donut Dinette, we had the Whispering Pines Barbecue, Log Cabin Barbecue. But more importantly in Albemarle was the quality of life and the people that was here. You know, it says you can never go home again. Well, you can if you're from the right place. And I can't put into words what tonight has meant to me. You know, being remembered at all that I played baseball in Stanley County, that's just an honor there. But this honor tonight is completely overwhelming. And I mean completely overwhelming. And you guys made me feel at home. So thank you, and may God bless you all.
I think Jeff was playing in the game that I broadcast at South Stanley early one spring. And it was so early that, excuse me, I'm going to have the same thing happen that day. The bugs and flies had just started getting out. When I was at South Stanley in those days, there was no outfield fence. You hit it in the gap, all you could get. One of the players from South Stanley did just that. Right between left and center, it was headed for the school building. I took a great big deep breath to bring him around in grandiose style, and one of those confounded bugs hit me right in the throat and wouldn't move. I gagged and coughed and wheezed. By the time I got through where I could even talk again, he was sitting in the dugout having made a home run. You were talking about Yogi Berra and his witticisms. He came to Duke to play in the Children's Classic a couple of years, so I got to know him a little bit. And one day, after our round, I said, Yogi, I got to ask you a question. I said, did you actually say all those things that people say you did? He thought, and he says, well, most of them that I've heard of, yes. He was never at a loss for words, and neither is our keynote speaker for this evening. He's been a good friend of mine for 24 years. Gary Hahn came to North Carolina State University to succeed a Wolfpack legend, Wally Ausley. He and I have several things in common, and one of those is I succeeded a Duke legend as well, Ad Penfield, who started the Duke Radio Network in 1938 at the behest of Wallace Wade. Gary has been the radio voice of the Wolfpack football and basketball since that 1991 season. And let's go back 20 years prior to Gary coming to NC State. He began his broadcasting career in 1970 while still a college student, and he also had a stint at WLWI-TV in Indianapolis in the mid-70s. From 1981 to 83, he was a sports anchor and reporter for NBC Radio Network in New York City. Before coming to NC State, he had worked on statewide radio sports networks for the University of Louisville, for Ohio State University, and for the University of Alabama. He was a part of the broadcast team when Louisville won the NCAA basketball championship in 1980, and he called the 1985 Rose Bowl for the Ohio State Radio Network. Also, Gary described the 1986 NIT championship that the Buckeyes won. In addition to his duties with the Wolfpack Sports Network, he did the play-by-play for the Carolina Cobras of the Arena Football League and the Raleigh-Durham Skyhawks of the World League of American Football. How many of you remember that? I know I do. Head coach was...
We lost every game.
Had a head coach by the name of Roman Gabriel.
Yep.
Traveled all over the world. But Gary is a 1974 graduate of Butler University in Indianapolis, Indiana, and has a BS degree in radio and TV. It now gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce you to the voice of the Wolfpack, my friend Gary Hahn. And Gary, we welcome you to Phyllis and my hometown.
Well, thank you, Bob. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I got to be honest with you. I'm here for one reason tonight, and that's because Tony Haynes, Mark Thomas, Jeff Gravely, and Don Shea are all booked up. That's the real reason I'm here. I was just looking at the back of this program here, and obviously it's an honor to be here tonight, but after I looked at the back and saw all the past speakers, man, it's really an honor. I mean, look at this. Al Wood, David Cutcliffe, Roy Williams, Mike Krzyzewski, Jay Billis, Dave Odom, Bill Dooley, and when it goes on and on, Bones McKinney, one of the greatest speakers that ever lived, Bobby Richardson. I want to be honest with you. I mean, this is the first time I've ever been a keynote speaker at any event. Little League Banquet, Girl Scout Cookie Sale Celebration, Daughters of the American Revolution. I mean, it doesn't matter. I mean, this is it. So if, you folks are going to have to cut me some slack tonight. I mean, that really intimidated me after I looked at the back of that program. Bob Harris called me about 3 months ago, and Bob and I are friends, and Bob knows that I really love the United States of America, so he picks up the phone, calls me, and he goes, Gary, I want to talk to you. And Bob's kind of politically bent anyway, so he leads me off with this question. He says, Gary, how do you feel about free speech? Are you for free speech in the Constitution? I'm thinking, what is this? And I said, sure, Bob, I love free speech. He says, good, because you're going to give one in 3 months. When Bob asked me about 3 months ago to come down here, I told him that, you know, I wasn't sure that I really had anything to add, anything to contribute. And then Bob intimidated me by saying that part of this program was to give you folks a little bit of an insight into my life. And that really intimidated me as well. That really made me uncomfortable. But it's real hard for me to say no to Bob Harris, and I'll tell you why. Because when I first came here, actually 25 years ago in 1990, Bob was the first ACC radio sportscaster to introduce himself to me. I remember we spent an afternoon together. We went out to lunch. He took me around, showed me, you know, where to go, kind of showed me the ropes, told me what to expect. And then he got me involved in a organization called the ACC Sports Writers and Broadcasters Association. And about 2 weeks later, they had an event, which I think they still have, but very few people now go because the ACC stopped underwriting it, and that's pretty expensive. And it used to be pretty cheap for all the members of the ACC Sports Writers and Broadcasters. But we would go up to the mountains, up to Grandfather Mountain, spend a weekend playing golf. And while we were up there, Bob kind of took me under his wing, introduced me to a lot of people. And I can still remember, I think it was about the 12th hole on Hound Ears. Bob is on the tee, and he rears back, and he hits this tremendous drive off to the right, and it just kept going and going and going, and it hit the top of one of the condos there, one of the high-rise condos on that golf course. And I still remember that. Do you remember that, Bob? Yeah, he said, you can't forget a shot like that. So I've never forgotten all the good things that Bob's done for me, and so I told him I would come up with something tonight. But this is a tough assignment for me. I mean, here we are honoring two Hall of Famers, and the only time I've ever been in a Hall of Fame is when my parents bought a ticket to get me in. I mean, that's and on top of that, I was not a great athlete by any stretch of the imagination. My only high school varsity sport was baseball, and I made the team as a sophomore. Sat the bench for 2 years, pitched a lot of batting practice. In fact, I pitched so much batting practice, my right arm is much bigger than my left arm because I pitch every day. I never got a rest. But finally, when some of the better guys ahead of me graduated, we got to my senior year, and I win the starting job as the second baseman on our high school baseball team, start every game, and in spite of me, we end up winning the county championship and the district A championship, which is far as that's as far as you could go back in the dark ages in Western Maryland. We didn't have a state championship because they didn't want to pay the coaches past about June the 6th. So everybody turned in their uniform, but we ended up winning that. I could throw pretty well. I could run real well. And I had some other skills, but the one thing I couldn't do, I couldn't hit. I could not hit my way out of a wet paper bag. I mean, for some guys in high school, you know, they go back and they remember all these great things, pitching three no-hitters, all that kind of stuff, a couple of home runs, knocking five runs, something like that. You know what my great moment was? A bases-loaded walk. That's what my great moment was. I mean, when I'm a junior, I'm rarely playing. I pitch batting practice every day. So the coach, you know, he tries to be nice to me because he wants me to keep doing that. He doesn't want to have to go out there and do it. So we're up. It's a road game. These games are seven innings in high school. We're up big. But we're batting in the top of the seventh, and the coach wants to get out of there. We got two on, two out. And I see him out of the corner of my eye. He looks at me, and he looks down there, and then our eyes meet, and he goes, "Han, grab a bat. Get up there and kill that rally, or I'm going to be late for dinner." And, of course, the whole dugout just explodes. Everybody's laughing at me. I get up there, and, you know, the guy wasn't – he was the head coach for a reason. I got up there and struck out and killed the rally. And then we go on to get the last three outs. He gets home on time. Everything's okay with the wife. But in spite of me, in 1970, we won those two championships that I'm talking about. And I mean in spite of me. We get to the 1970 county championship game, and seven-inning game. We're up in the 6-2-1. Guy comes up. We're playing our arch rival, Fort Hill High School. This is in Western Maryland, up in the mountains. And this kid comes up, and he hits this towering pop-up down the right field line. You've seen this on television a million times. There's only one guy that can get this ball. And who do you think it is? You're looking at him. Well, I'm hauling it to try and get to this ball. I'm the only one that can get to it. Right fielder has no chance. First baseman has no chance. I'm doing my best. I'm looking over my shoulder. I'm trying to make this really hard catch. And the bottom line is I don't get it done. And this guy ends up on second base, and the official scorer charges me with a two-base error. Well, the next guy up rips a line drive to left field for a base hit. Guy comes around, scores, and I'm the GOAT. But wait a minute, as Lee Corso says, "Not so fast, my friend," because I hear a voice in the stands, and it's a familiar voice. It's my mom. She's yelling. But she's not yelling at me. She's yelling, "He missed third base. He missed third base." And then my dad's sitting next to her. He wakes up. He goes, yeah, he missed third base. Well, all of a sudden, they got the whole stands going. He missed third base. And so, you know, my coach is no dummy. He sees that, and he tells the pitcher to throw to third on an appeal play. Third baseman catches it, steps on the bag. Umpire's right hand goes up, out! And I'm the most relieved man in America. Because I go from being the GOAT to being part of a championship team. We get the last three outs, blank them the rest of the way, and we end up winning 2-1. But that's kind of been the whole theme of my life. I mean, that's redemption, folks. That is truly redemption, and that's been kind of what my whole life is about in a nutshell. Adversity followed by redemption. Mistakes followed by forgiveness. Adversity followed by redemption. So that's my theme tonight, adversity and redemption. I don't know the intimate details of the lives of either of our Hall of Fame inductees, but I can guarantee you this. You can't be in anybody's Hall of Fame. I don't care if it's a broadcaster's Hall of Fame, duck calling Hall of Fame. It doesn't matter. You've faced adversity somewhere down the line. And I congratulate these two men for what they did athletically in Stanley County and for their honor tonight, because this is really special stuff. But the bottom line is, you know, we all face adversity. And how you handle adversity is one of the great challenges in life. It really is. Adversity is either going to make you better or it's going to make you bitter. It's either going to make you weaker or it's going to make you stronger. And you're either going to get victory over adversity or it's going to defeat you. So how do you get victory over adversity? Well, the big secret is one word, It's called attitude. It's been said that life isn't so much what happens to you, but it's how you react to it. That's what really counts. You can't control what happens to you. A lot of times we have absolutely no control. We just get caught up in things. You have cancer, didn't have any control over that, but it's how you respond to it that really counts, and you have a choice to do that. And I'm not saying this as a person with no experience. I've had my share of adversity, and I'm going to be real transparent with you because I want to make a real important point tonight. By the grace of God, I'm a cancer survivor. I've faced the death of family members. I've been fired. I've been downsized. And before coming to North Carolina, I had two failed marriages. And after the second one, I lost everything. And I do mean everything, including my health for a while. I was hospitalized for a short period of time with what the doctors diagnosed as not just depression, but major depression. Lost my finances, lost my career for a period of time. And financially, there were a couple of times where I was literally, and it's maybe hard for you to believe, but I was literally just a couple of days away from homelessness. And I was too proud to call my parents or any of my relatives and ask them for money because I'd made some bad decisions and I was paying the consequences for that. And I had the idea that I got myself into this, I was going to get myself out of it. And when you're kind of down to your last buck, that's when the pressure is really on. And I needed money fast in one of these situations. And I knew that there were only a few jobs where people were paid in cash. And I knew one of them was to wait on tables. I knew another one was to drive a taxi cab. They always get paid in cash. Well, I didn't want anybody to see me in the condition that I was in. So I chose to drive a taxi cab on the all-night shift from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m., basically because I knew the clientele that would be in that cab, that clientele was not going to be anybody that knew me. And there was a reason for that. I mean, my life had hit bottom, and I didn't want anybody to see me because I thought I was absolutely worthless. And I was lower than dirt. I mean, I really was. My attitude was poor. Part of that was due to the fact that I was ill, and I was trying to recover from this this illness. But another part of it was just old-fashioned self-pity. It really was. At one point, I sank so low that I came back to my little one-room apartment that I was able to live in, and I just came to the realization that I'd had enough. And I started yelling at the walls, I started yelling at God, and I told him that I'd had it, and that I wanted out, and I didn't care how he did it. Car wreck, doesn't really matter, but I'm not going to do it, because I'm a coward. You're going to get me out of here. Well, you better watch what you ask God for, because about 3 weeks later, I'm driving the cab at about 2 o'clock in the morning, and all of a sudden, I get caught up in something that's beyond my control. I'm the victim of an armed robbery. I got a guy sitting in the front seat. He pulls out this knife. It's something they used at the Alamo. I mean, it was scary. Other guys in the back seat, he's beating on me from the top. I didn't know whether these guys had guns. I didn't know what. But I started praying to God at that point. God, please let me live. And he did. He saved my life that night. I got pretty badly beaten up, but I didn't get stabbed. And after a short visit in the hospital ER, I was back on my way. But I'll tell you something, my attitude changed 360 degrees. I didn't know what the future was going to hold, but I knew that I wanted to live, and I knew that God had saved my life. And I came to the conclusion that coming to know God and living for him was what I wanted to do. That's where I wanted my life to go. And so that's what I did. I focused on him. And God started working. Of course, he had been working before then. I just didn't realize and I just didn't see it. But I was starting to see it now. He healed me of my depression. He started to put my life back together. And I think everybody knows God's timing is perfect. And when the perfect time came, He brought me to North Carolina. Wally Ausley retired as a longtime voice of the Wolfpack. There were 130 other applicants for that job, and I knew I wasn't the most talented. But if God wants you somewhere, you'll be there. If he doesn't want you somewhere, you got no chance. You won't get there or you won't stay. It's just not going to happen. And coming to North Carolina and representing NC State Athletics on radio has truly been the biggest blessing of my life. Over and over again, my life's been about adversity and redemption, mistakes and forgiveness. And handling adversity is all about how you respond. I didn't respond very well in the beginning, but after that traumatic event that God engineered, I started to respond the right way. Handling adversity is how you respond. I'm going to read a little quote from Chuck Swindoll's book, Strengthening Your Grip. He says, and I quote, "The longer I live, the more I realize the impact of attitude on life. Attitude to me is more important than facts. It's more important than education, than money, than circumstances, than failures, than successes, than what other people think or do. It's more important than appearance, giftedness, or skill. It'll make or break a company, a church, a home, and I'll add a football or a basketball team. It'll break that too. And the remarkable thing is, says Chuck Swindoll, is that we have a choice every day regarding the attitude we're going to embrace for that day. He goes on to say, we can't change our past. We can't change the fact that people will react in a certain way. We can't change the inevitable. The only thing we can do is play the one string that we have, and that's our attitude. And I'm convinced that life is 10% what happens, 90% how I react to it." End of quote. And that is so true. Handling adversity is about attitude. It's about how we respond. But redemption, that's a different story. That's all about God and his work, because we can't do it. You may have guessed that I'm a committed Christian. I believe the Bible. I believe the Bible is the inspired word of God. I believe it's the game plan for life. And I had to learn that the hard way. The major theme of the Bible is how man can have eternal life. And man can't have eternal life without redemption. It just isn't going to happen. Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, came to this earth for just that reason. Because we're separated from God. God is holy and can't look on sin. And the first man that God ever made, Adam, turned against him in sin. Sin entered the world, and everything changed. And because we're all descendants of Adam, we're all sinners. And sin separates us from God. But Jesus Christ made it possible for us to have a relationship with our Creator. He came to this earth, took our sins upon his sinless body, and died on a Roman cross 2,000 years ago. Your sins, my sins, the sins of the world, he died one time. And then Jesus rose from the dead to prove that he was Almighty God. So redemption is God's work. And I go back to that period that I just mentioned a moment ago where I asked God to get me out of this world. Well, I'm really glad he didn't do that. I'm glad that sometimes he doesn't give us what we think we want, because if he had, you'd have another speaker tonight. I'm sure there are some out there, probably Carolina fans, that thought God made a mistake, right? Well, he didn't. God doesn't make any mistakes. And he had a plan for my life, and he's got a plan for your life. And all he wants you to do is surrender to Jesus Christ. And it's amazing, but when you do, your attitude starts changing. And all of a sudden, you've got a solid foundation to deal with adversity that you didn't have before. The Bible kind of calls it standing on the solid rock instead of the sinking sand. And fortunately, I'm able to stand on that solid rock. The Bible verse that sums up my life is Psalm 119:71, which says, "It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your secrets and your decrees." And what that means is that it was good for me to go through all of that adversity so that I could come to know God and live for him. And that's the most important thing we can do on this earth. It affects how we're going to live the rest of the days that we have, and it's going to affect where we spend eternity. And I wouldn't know God today if I hadn't gone through all of that. I'd still be out there lost, and I can guarantee you, the way I was going, I would have destroyed myself, and I would be physically dead, and there would be another speaker up here tonight. So my message in closing to you tonight is this. Maybe you're not facing adversity now. Maybe things are going great, but it's coming. It's coming. Be ready for it. And when life throws you a lemon, squeeze it. Get the most out of it that you can. Find out who God is and what he's trying to teach you, and let him help you develop the right attitude. And then start to muster up enough faith to leave the outcome to God. Because redemption is God's work. So my time's up. Thank you for your time and for listening. It's been a true honor to be here and to be your keynote speaker. Thank you.
When Gary got here earlier, I was telling him about some of our former speakers, and I just happened to mention Coach K and Roy Williams, and he said, well, I hope I can live up to that. And I said, you're going to do just fine. I think we all would agree that he probably exceeded what we heard those nights when they were here. To remind you that this will be rebroadcast on Time Warner Cable Channel 21. We appreciate their efforts. We appreciate Leon Warren and Matt Smith and the radio station for talking up the event. And I know everyone's starving, as am I, and we have plenty of food that Chef Tim prepared for you. I really appreciate everyone coming tonight. Congratulations, Jeff. Congratulations, Brad. And we hope to see you again in next year's Sports Hall of Fame induction ceremony. And with that, have a nice night.